Hello everyone, this is Nikita Shikwal, co-admin of Astrovedic Enthusiast FB Astrology Group, and as always, we are back with another super duper interesting astrological interview session. And today's topic is again one of the most discussed, and it is one of the most important aspects in the era that we are living, which is the role of malefic planets in Kali Yuga. And to enlighten us more about the same, we have a very special and knowledgeable guest with us. Please welcome Babajit Kalita from Exotic Astrology.
Thank you so much.
So, welcome back, Babajit. And this is the second time that we are recording together. And I just want to thank you on behalf of Zen Ma'am, admin of Astrovedic Enthusiast AV Group, and all the management team and members of AV Group. And it's always been an great honor and a great pleasure to interact with you, to watch your videos, and to be able to learn from you. So thank you for accepting our invite.
My pleasure, and thank you for your time, and thank you for Zen Madam for sending the invite. We did it in quite a short notice.
Yeah.
There you go. So malefics today. So who is on the target?
Okay.
You said we last, right? So you want to start with the questions, or should I speak about malefics first?
Yeah, you can speak about malefics first. The stage is all yours.
Okay. So traditionally, they say that among the nine planets, three planets are malefics. One is Saturn, the other one is Rahu, and the other one is Ketu, of course.
Yeah.
But because of our conditioning, there are two other planets also which behave as if they are malefics, that is Sun and Mars. But inherently, they are not malefics.
Yeah.
Because Sun and Mars cannot be malefics because they are Suras. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And Mercury, Venus actually cannot be benefics. Because they are Asuras.
Mm-hmm.
When I talk of malefics and benefics, there you can talk of them at two levels. You know, one is at the mundane materialistic realm, and other one is at a higher spiritual realm. So the members change there. You know? And there Ketu is also not a malefic there. So Ketu goes on the other side. So here the ones are left, Mercury, Venus, Saturn and Rahu. These four are the malefics when it comes to spiritual progress. And in general, you can say all the remaining five, like for example, Sun, Mars, Saturn, Rahu, Ketu, at a material sense, for our materialistic world, is these five are malefics. But among them, the three are most prominent. Now, the thing is, what is the meaning of the word malefic actually? So many times people think that the word malefic means bad. That's the most famous word, you know.
Perception word, yeah.
Yeah, it is bad. You know, they are bad planets. And the malefics are good planets, you know, they are very nice.
Yeah.
The problem is people, most of the times, they don't understand what is good and bad.
Mm-hmm.
So if you see traditionally in the Vedic culture, in Indian culture, all these planets are included always. In any aspect of Vedic culture, you will never see any planet is excluded. Never, ever, ever. So for example, let's take the example of Mars. So Mars is what? Mars is our ability to stay independent and do things independently without the help of others. That's what Mars is. Now, Mars is basically, he's the significator of independence. So sometimes people think that in Vedic culture, there's a lot of dependence on others. That people think that, oh, the man is dependent on the husband is dependent on the wife for some certain thing. When the wife is dependent on the husband, they think like
dependent on her man, yeah.
But actually it is not like that. That happens because we do not know the overall ethos of the Vedic culture, and we try to analyze things, you know, like dots and pieces, and then we seeing all these flaws. We think that, oh, the man is dependent on wife for the household work, and the wife is dependent on the husband for money, right? That's the common perception. But that's not how it works. The culture was not like that. How was Vedic culture is? Vedic culture was very evolved. So what do you mean by evolvement? Evolvement means there are three levels actually. One is dependence. The level higher than that is independence. And a level even higher than that is interdependence. So many times people think that dependence and interdependence is like, they look very similar. So for example, if you read the Ramayana, or not the Ramayana, you can also read Ramayana, but if you read the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, there you will see Krishna and Sudama story is there. So it looks like a very normal, generic story of the Gurukul. So what they are doing actually in the Gurukul? They are doing all the work which a traditional housewife would do in India. All the household work they are doing. But the question is, if they are men, then why they are doing that work? So this means that there is no way a sense of dependence that, you know, the man is dependent on the wife or the wife is dependent on the husband. It's not like that. It means that everybody is good at the thing which they do. So by that, they are not dependent. They are independent, actually. But when they behave, they don't behave like that. As if, you know, I am independent, you know, you stay there, I stay here. It's not like that. Because dependence will make you weak and miserable. And independence makes you lonely.
Yeah.
Okay, so those people who are very much independent minded, they are always miserable and they are very lonely all the time. These are all typical traits of Mars. But when you evolve more as an individual, then you know that the world cannot exist in independence. There is no happiness in independence. There is happiness when a person is interdependent, which means I know I can do something, but I will not do. I will do this and you will do that, even though you can do what I am doing. By that, there is society. By that, there is culture. By that, there is a merging of ideas, people, and, you know, beliefs. And that's how societies are formed. So societies are built on interdependence, which is actually Jupiter. Mm-hmm. And if you see, that's what the malefics represent. You know, malefics don't represent bad things. Malefics represent the traits of independence inside us, which is very much mm-hmm. required.
Because, in today's era, it is very...
Yeah, because either it's today's era or it was like 100 or 1000 years ago or in any culture, anywhere, you always had to be independent and then you had to be interdependent. So, for example, they said that when a king would have a childbirth, that was a boy, then he would maybe become the next king. But he was not just pampered all the time, you know. So in the scriptures it is said, first 5 years you should only pamper the child. First 5 years, no rules, no restriction. He's shouting, he's, you know, jumping, dancing, whatever he's doing, let him do. But after 5 years, you have to discipline the child. So discipline is what? Discipline is a way to make him independent. That's what discipline is. Otherwise, the child will never be able to do things himself or himself herself. The child will always feel, oh, I need my mother to eat. I need my mother for this. I need my father for this. So it is not that the malefics are bad, because if the malefics are bad, then we will never evolve as a person inside. We will always remain dependent on the others. But the problem with today's society is the malefics have been glorified to such an extent that people think that they will start behaving like benefics. So for example, independence, you know, Mars can never behave like Jupiter. Jupiter is that person who takes everybody together. So the thing is, malefics have their own place and benefics have their own place. And the word used for malefics is krura. That's the word. And English also has a word, cruel. Krura and cruel, you know, it sounds very similar. And the word used for benefics is somya. Now, the word somya has many meanings. You know, one of the meanings is very easygoing. Now, what does it mean by easygoing? Does it mean that things happen easily? Maybe, but that's not exactly what it means. It means that things, it is easier for you to get that job done. Now, that can happen in two ways. Or I would say there is only one. How it happens is your surroundings are better. So, for example, suppose you have to achieve some work. Okay. Let me give you an example. Suppose you have to file some application and you have gone to some office. So now when you go to the office, what happens? Now, suppose you don't know anybody in the office. Then what you have to do? You have to take a pen and a paper and write the application. It's a bit painful writing stuff. You have to ask, where should I put account number, or you want to withdraw or deposit money. But now suppose in that same bank, your uncle or your auntie, somebody sitting there. Okay. And maybe that uncle is like, you know, the branch manager. So what happens? You will go to, now you will not go to the cashier or that machine, you see. Of course, you can go to the ATM, but suppose you want something more. So then what you will do, you will directly go to that branch manager because he's your mama or chacha or whoever, uncle. And then what happens? Your uncle, what he says, give me the form, he fills it, right, for you.
Yeah.
And then what he says at the end, please sign here.
True.
So now what is happening? You could have done that the same way through the person who is officially in charge. And now also you are doing it, but what is the difference? It's happening in a very... you are getting a lot of support from somebody else. So that...
In an easier manner.
Yeah, that that is the prime difference between malefics and benefics. Benefics will give you circumstances where others will help you, either help you in achieving that task or help you to get out of something which you don't want.
True.
But malefics do not offer any help. Malefics say, no help, you got to do it yourself. So imagine there is a fancy world where there are only two planets. Just imagine. So imagine there are two horoscopes only, and imagine there is only one house, the 10th house. So imagine there is one chart where a person has Jupiter in the 10th house. And you imagine there is another chart where there is a Saturn in the 10th house. So now imagine that there are no lords or there's nothing, you know, there's only one dasha which will run all this. So that person is born and Jupiter dasha has started. And then the other person is born and his Saturn Mahadasha has started. So what will happen actually? Will it happen that the person who has Jupiter in the 10th house, he will rise higher, or the one who has Saturn in the 10th will rise higher? Actually,
they will, Saturn.
Actually, they will rise the same.
Okay.
Some people think, oh, it's benefic, so he will rise more. Some people think, oh, no, it's malefic. He will work harder, he will rise more. No, they will rise the same. Yeah. The rise is dependent on the house, not on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if Saturn was in the 11th and Jupiter was in the 10th, then if you say Saturn will give more promotions and more money, you are perfectly correct.
Mm-hmm.
Because no planet, every planet's agenda is to make that house work, to function for that house. Because many times people think that Rahu in the 7th is bad for the 7th house.
Mm-hmm.
Or they say Saturn in the 7th is bad for 7th, or you know, Rahu in, not Rahu, I would say Ketu in 10th is bad. When you are saying that a planet is bad for that house, you are inherently contradicting yourself, because every planet is a manifestation of yourself. So when you are saying that your Saturn is not good for your 10th house, it's like saying a part of you is not good for you. It doesn't work like that. So every planet is good for that house. I am very careful with my words. I didn't say good for the horoscope. I said every planet is good for that house. So that essentially means if Saturn is in the 10th house, Saturn will give you results of the 10th house. Rahu is in the 10th house. Rahu will give you results of the 10th house. Rahu in the 7th does not break the marriage, for God's sake. How can a planet in the 7th break the marriage? Otherwise, what is the planet doing there? 7th house doesn't break marriages. The 6th house does. So what happens is sometimes people say that in Rahu, Mahadasha, Antardasha, the marriage broke. It's not like that. What could happen is your Mahadasha Lord may be signifying the 6th house. And that is why the marriage is broken. And Rahu, Ketu and Saturn, they are by nature separative. Separative means what do you mean separative? Separative means you are all alone. So again, that bank example, nobody is there to help you. So you are all alone. You have to write the application yourself and you have to do everything yourself. So when, now if suppose somebody's dasha is indicating the 6th house and then Rahu comes, then there could be some issues. But Rahu alone in the 7th or Saturn alone in the 10th, I mean, why will they damage their own house? I mean, why will a planet damage its own house? It will never do that. So the difference is that if somebody has Saturn in the 10th, compared to somebody has Jupiter or Mercury or Venus in the 10th, the only difference is in their surroundings. So that means somebody has Saturn in the 10th, he has to work his way out to get that promotion or that job or, you know, that success.
Yes.
He will not get any help. Now, of course, if the Mahadasha is of Jupiter, that's different. But we are talking of an imaginary scenario. Now, there's only one planet in the chart. So he's running Saturn Mahadasha, Saturn Antardasha, and he's running Saturn's Pratyanta. So that means that he will get a lot of things, because ultimately it's the 10th house. He will get a lot of name, fame and all these things. And now suppose somebody has Jupiter in the 10th. Then what will happen? Then people will come and, you know, put garland onto him. Congratulations, sir. You got this position. You know, you are great. Jupiter is praise. You know, people will praise you. Venus is gifts. If Venus is there, you will get gifts, you know. But if Saturn is there, what do you get? You get a contract.
Yeah.
You do contract. So now you have to work for 40 hours, like in Europe, like or 37, 36 hours in some company. And then you sign it very happily. So are you understanding the difference? The malefics, they will force you to work yourself without any help. And the benefics will always offer you help. And now you may be thinking, who will offer me help? What kind of help will I get? So for that, you have to check the lords of the houses which that planet is lording. and you have to see the nature of the planet. So for example, if it is a benefic like Mercury, then Mercury is like maybe your third lord. Then it can happen that your connections, you know, and they help you in communication. It can be like this. And if it is malefics, if it is a malefic, then suppose Saturn is your 10th lord and he's sitting somewhere maybe in the 6th house. Then your boss will come and give you the promotion, but your boss will also tell you you have to sign the contract. So the most important thing we need to understand is that malefics are not, they're not bad planets. They make us strong in a level that we can be independent. But that does not mean, as I said in the beginning, it does not mean that they will make us happy. Malefics cannot make us happy. If you want happiness in life, you have to go to the benefics. The malefics can never replace benefics. Because malefics talk of independence and benefics talk of interdependence. So independence will always be lower than interdependence. And many times people have the biggest misconception in, because you have named the topic, you know, malefics in Kali Yuga.
Yeah.
So I will use the word Kali Yuga. In Kali Yuga, the biggest misconception is that a person who is independent is very strong. He is more stronger than somebody who is interdependent, because interdependence is seen as weakness. But if you look closely at their lives, you will realize they are the most miserable. So now what's the solution? The solution is don't be dependent. Solution is you be independent, and then, but don't stay there. It's miserable. It's lonely there. And then
so maintain a fine line and difference between these two aspects, right?
Because see, if you see in astrology, which are the houses of happiness? There are only four houses of happiness. That is the second house, the fifth house, the ninth house, and the 11th house. And which is that one planet who is the karaka for all these four houses?
Jupiter.
Yes, he alone is the karaka for all these houses. Can you believe it? That is why Krishna says in the Gita, among planets, I am Brihaspati. That is the reason he says that. He doesn't say among planets.
What moon?
He doesn't say among planets, I am Shukra. He doesn't say among planets, you know. And now you asked about moon. He says, among the nakshatras, I am moon. He says, nakshatranam aham sashi. That shloka is there in the Gita. Now somebody may be thinking that, oh, moon is not a nakshatra, but why is Krishna telling that among the nakshatras, I am the moon? Why does Krishna say that? Because in that chapter, which is like he's describing his own opulences, like he says, among demons, I am Prahlad, among Pandavas, I am Arjun, Pandava Nam Dhananjaya. Then he says, among planets, I am Brihaspati, and among the nakshatras, I am the moon. So moon is the controller of the nakshatras. So Krishna is telling that I am not one of the nakshatras, I am directly the moon. Because unless I go there, the nakshatra is not activated. The nakshatras will only be activated when moon is going there. And unless, and the Vimshottari Dasha starts from moon. So if moon is not there, nothing is there, because moon is the mind. The mind is actually a way to enjoy this world. So fun is the way by which you have resources in this world. But resources will not make you happy if you are not able to enjoy them. And moon in general is enjoyment, any kind of enjoyment. And Venus represents more of the love, physical and that. And Mercury represents more of the monetary pleasure. But the prime houses of happiness, they are these four houses. So many times people ask this question, blazing fiery question, that which are houses of free will in astrology? How much free will do I have actually? So the answer is, these four houses are the houses of free will. The Upachya houses are not the houses of free will. Upachya houses get better with time when you put efforts. But that doesn't mean Upachya houses give you free will. But the houses 2nd, 5th, 9th and 11th, they are the houses of free will, because They make you happy, and when you are happier, you are more likely to make a better decision. More likely. So suppose a person is very angry, then the probability that he goes and beats somebody or abuses somebody is much more than if he is happier, or if he is very calm and he's cool and he's joyful. Now, of course, this is not a license that you are angry, then go and beat somebody. But when you are happy internally, then you have the free will. Because if you are not happy, then it is almost like saying you have the free will, but you still don't. Or you have it, but you cannot use it in a right direction. Any house you take, for example, if you take sixth house, so that's the house of weakness. You know, so if you have weaknesses, you know, the weaknesses will pull you down. Kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya, they will pull you down. So to the degree a person, second house, fifth house, ninth house, 11th house, these houses have strong planets placed in them, or the lords of these four houses are strong and well placed, to that degree the person can use their free will in a better way. And to the degree it is not, to that degree they are helpless. And here free will is very important. Whenever it comes to malefics, we have to understand free will. Many times people ask this question, what is free will? How much free will do I have? Actually, this question is, or I would say the other way around, people ask, how can we change our destiny? Have you heard of this question?
Many times.
Or they will ask, in astrology, how much destiny can we change?
No.
So I had once asked this to my guru, then he said, your question is self-contradictory. Because the word destiny means one, that which is fixed, that it will happen. So if you are saying that, can I change my destiny, then how is it destiny? It's like a paradox. Because destiny means it has to happen. You cannot change it. No remedy is, nothing can alter the prarabdha. It's not possible. But then what is free will then? Free will is generally seen as a competitor to destiny, you know.